daughters of the house of slavery, you shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make yourself an idol, whether in the form of anything that is in heaven above, or that is on the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing children for the iniquity of parents to the third and fourth generation of those who reject me, but showing steadfast love to a thousand generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. The word of the Lord.
As you're able, I invite you to stand with me as we read the Holy Gospel. This morning, the Gospel reading is from St. Matthew, the 9th chapter. Glory to the Lord. When they came to Capernaum, and when Jesus was in the house, he asked them, "What were you arguing about on the way?" But they were silent, for on the way they had argued with one another who was the greatest. So he sat down, called the 12, and said to them, "Whoever wants to be first must be last of all and servant of all." And then he took a little child and put it among them, and taking it in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me. And whoever welcomes me welcomes not me, but the one who sent me." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. Well, through these Sundays, and just an observation, we videotape our services and then we put them on our website. And I was just looking, not that I'd like to listen to myself preach, but when you look at those videos, I don't know if any of you have, it looks, whoever's preaching, it looks like the preacher's preaching to nobody, because all you get are these rows up in front, and it doesn't look like anybody's in church. So, and we know that there are some people in church, right? So there are at least important people in church. So I'm moving up, so at least maybe we can get you sleeping. If you fall asleep during the sermon, then we'll get you on video. Well, we're moving through these Sundays in Lent, and our worship services have focused on the core of our being, namely our souls. And we've been invited to take care of our souls, or as our book suggests, keep our souls. And you've heard it the last several weeks, and guess what? You'll hear it again this week. There are books available. So if you haven't picked up a book yet, we are working through chapters 12 through 14. This week, and so if you haven't picked up a book, we certainly invite you to pick one up and catch up with us, or if you just want an impressive book for your coffee table or something, you might want to take one of these books. So maybe you don't have time to read it now, but maybe in the coming weeks you'll have time. So we've got plenty of books, and we really don't want to have to send them back. So take a book if you haven't received one yet. It's the study of the soul. That's what we're talking about these weeks of Lent, and it's the deepest part of you. And for all eternity, it will stand, your soul will stand in some relationship with God. And so we tend to the soul, we care for the soul, we're focusing on keeping the soul because it's the most important thing that you can do, is care and keep the soul. So today we're going to talk about the soul's need for freedom. Not just to be free from sin, not just to be free from guilt, not just to be free from other needs that our soul has. Maybe it's regret, maybe it's anger, maybe it's resentment. We're not talking about just being free from these things, but we're talking about the soul's need for freedom in order for the soul to be free for some things. Not to be free from, but to be free for. To be freed for something that's greater than yourself. To be freed for something that's more than just your own soul. So we're talking about freedom today. today. To be blessed, yes, to be free in God's blessing, but to be a blessing, to be free to be a blessing to others. Now, I don't know if you've ever had this experience before, but it's happened to me several times. Have you ever read a child, a bedtime story? You've, part of your bedtime routine, part of one thing that children love. They love to be read stories. So whether you're a parent or a grandparent or maybe a neighbor, maybe an aunt or an uncle, maybe you've had the opportunity to read a child a bedtime story. Children look forward to that along with their evening prayers, right? Along with their, I know they really look forward to their bedtime prayers, but the stories is what they really look forward to. And maybe this has been your experience. It's bedtime and you've had a ton of other things that need to be done, but it's bedtime. It's time to put your child or your grandson or daughter to bed. And one of the common routines at bedtime is to read a book, to say prayers, but also to read. So you have on your mind a ton of things that need to get done yet that evening. So the child goes to the bookshelf. And what typically does the child do? The child normally picks the largest and the longest book on the bookshelf, right? I mean, that's just Murphy's Law. The more things you have to do that evening, the bigger the book your child picks. And so they climb into bed, or maybe this, maybe they bring a whole pile of books with them into bed with you to read. And so as one book is finished, the child calls out what? Can we read another story? Just one more story. Just one more story. And I think it's a somewhat common strategy, at least for busy parents, at least on occasion, to walk into a child's room full of books and, of course, grab the shortest story that you know. The storybook with what? The most pictures, right? A storybook with what? The largest print, right? That's what you're choosing. The book with the fewest pages, and then to read it through. And maybe if it is a longer book, you're going to read that book really, really fast, right? You're just going to race through that book until that child says, no, wait, stop. Why are you reading so fast, Dad? Or maybe you've done this. You've taken your storybook and you've tried to sneak in like 3 or 4 pages at each turn. Have you ever tried to do that? And then you try to paraphrase or you try to summarize, just so you can get through that book faster, and inevitably it happens, Daddy, you're turning the pages wrong because children know their stories, don't they? They know them and you can't fool them, or at least I can't fool my kids. So it'd be like, give me the book and I'll turn the pages for you, Dad, right? Because we've got a ton of things going on, don't we? And we want to get through that time. And I think it's kind of chilling to reflect on that, I mean, really, what's the hurry? What's the hurry? What are you in such a hurry to do? The hurry is that most of us live at a pace of life where whatever we may be doing, we are painfully aware of what we haven't done yet. Isn't that true? Whatever we're doing, we're painfully aware of what we haven't done yet. Or what task is waiting for us when the current one is done. Or what we should be doing instead of what we're doing right now. Or where we would rather be, which is always somewhere else than where we're at in the present or in the moment. And so we hurry through so much of what's right in front of us. And sometimes I think, heaven forbid, sometimes we even do that right here when we gather for worship. I mean, we take for granted the moment that we are in, the moment that we are in worship in this space, and our souls are not in this moment of worship, are they? I mean, a lot of times our souls are thinking about what we need to get done today, or what we need to get done during the week. And the frightening thing about the bedtime story anecdote that I just told you is this. What might the child be missing as you try to rush through bedtime stories or as you try to skip pages? What might that child be missing? Or maybe even a better question. What are you missing? are you missing as you try to rush through that time? What are you missing as you try to skip multiple pages with your child? What story are you missing in your life as you try to hurry through that bedtime story? And if we can agree that something is missed when we rush through our time with our child, doesn't it stand to reason that in other things that we rush through, just to squeeze maybe a few more seconds out of the day, that we might be missing something there too? As we live outside the moment that we are in, the here and the now. I mean, I don't mind the things in life that are more convenient than they used to be. Don't get me wrong. I don't mind saving time when I can save time. But my fear is that when we rush, when we skim through the surface of life, then we fail to make real connections with the world. And perhaps we fail to make real connections with the people that God has placed in our path during the day, or during the hour, or during the minute. That's what I fear. The passage that we read from Mark, I think, is like that. Jesus is traveling with his disciples for a day, and as you remember, he picks up on the conversation that the disciples were having outside of his presence. And you can maybe picture, and there they are walking on the road all day long with Jesus, the very Son of God. And, you know, if you were walking with the Son of God, if you were walking with the Savior of the world, wouldn't you just stop and enjoy that moment? I mean, wouldn't you maybe just love to be in dialogue with this Jesus, to ask him some questions? But that's not what the disciples are doing. They're not enjoying the Son of Man's presence, the Son of God's presence, and enjoying that moment that they were given with him. But the disciples walk down the road not enjoying any of the blessing of walking with Jesus. They begin to think about where they would rather be, arguing about who is greatest in the kingdom of heaven, arguing about who might be their leader once Jesus is gone. They're not thinking about the present moment, they're thinking about the future. Which one of us is the greatest, they ask? Which one of us will lead the group after Jesus is gone? And of course, realizing that I'm no better than anyone else, my guess is that if I had been there, I probably would have done the same. I probably would have hurried through that moment as well, trying to turn several pages at a time instead of just enjoying the moment, enjoying the blessing that is given to me by walking with this Jesus. But in order to show the disciples what they're missing, Jesus takes a child in his arms and he says, "Whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me." The one who welcomes me is the one that welcomes God into their life, or we might say in these weeks, welcomes God into their very intimate and inner being of themselves, the soul. Welcoming God into the soul. We also have before us this morning the reading of the Ten Commandments from the book of Exodus, and it is incredibly significant that the Ten Commandments were given just 3 months after the Hebrews were freed from slavery in the land of Egypt. The Ten Commandments were given just 3 months after they had moved into this incredible freedom from the bondage that they had with Pharaoh, the terrible bondage that they experienced for over 400 years. And so just 3 months they were given these Ten Commandments. And God heard the cries of his people who were in slavery. God parted the waters of the Red Sea to bring them out of it. But the question is, were they really free yet? After passing through the Red Sea, I am certain that these runaway slaves expected Moses to take the highway to the Promised Land. get there as quickly as possible. Take the short road. And there was actually a highway. There actually was a short road. It was called the Way of the Philistines, and it was about a 150-mile-long road that went along the Mediterranean coast. Heavily traveled. It had lots of food, lots of places to stay, lots of water along the way. It probably even had a few Starbucks, maybe a couple of Qdobas, maybe some Buffalo Wild Wings that probably had drive-through service, I'm sure. But scholars estimate that if the Hebrew people had taken this road, the road of the Philistines, the Hebrews would have arrived at the promised land in a matter of weeks. A matter of weeks. You remember how long it took the Hebrew people to enter into the promised land? It took them 40 years. 40 years. God did not take the easy, quick, fast route for the Hebrew people. Instead, he led the people south, down into the desert wilderness of the Sinai, where there was no water, where there was no food, where there were armed bandits that kind of roamed the roads looking for an easy prey. That's the road that God took the Hebrew people. It was the road where the Hebrew people thought that they were going to literally die. So why does God do this? Why does God always take his people into the wilderness of adversity to the promised land? Why doesn't God take God's people the easy route, the quick route? Why is it always the long route? Why is it always the route of hardship and suffering and despair? Have you ever experienced those things as you travel? Why does God make us go on those roads instead of the quick, easy roads in life? Well, because if we just keep following God, we will eventually discover something magnificent that is found only on the long, hard, and difficult roads in life. And that is this: the transformation of the soul. That is what we find when we go through the long, difficult journeys. It transforms our souls. It is for this reason that the commandments begin with an important prologue. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. In other words, God is telling us, remember who I am and remember what I have done. Always remember who I am and remember what I have done for you. I have brought you out of the land of slavery. Remember what I have done. I have set your soul free. I have given you this freedom. And this establishes the key to everything that follows. I mean, Jesus even said, if the Son has set you free, then you are free indeed. These commandments depict God's character. These commandments depict the character of Jesus himself. Ours is a God who liberates us and who will not tolerate anything but liberation for us and freedom for us. His history with you began when he found your soul enslaved by something, and God heard your soul's cry, and he freed you. He freed you from whatever that was troubling you. God heard your soul's cry, and he delivered you from that. And that is what the Exodus was all about. It is also what the cross of Jesus Christ is about. And that is why Christians love the cross. That's why we wear it, right? That's why we wear it as a neck piece. We wear it as a necklace. That's why we gather under the cross when we come here to worship. It is our symbol of freedom. The cross is our symbol of freedom. In the life of Jesus Christ, God entered our world and found those who were enslaved by our sins, and by the cross, Christ delivered us from those sins. And on the cross, Christ died to give us freedom. So why does God want you to be free so badly that he would give God's only Son to die on the cross? To make sure that you live in freedom. Why is this so important to this God? Well, I believe it's so important to this God because there are some things that you can only do in freedom. There are some things that you are called to do in your freedom. And that is to love. That is to love each other. In fact, when Jesus summarized the commandments, he summarized the entire law. And you remember what he said. He said, love the Lord your God with all your heart and your mind and your soul. And love your neighbor as yourself. You see, there are only some things that we can do in freedom. God has freed you to love, to stop rushing through your life, to stop turning multiple pages in your book. God has freed you to love and welcome God, to love and welcome your neighbor, to love and welcome even your enemy, to love and welcome yourself. God has freed you to love. Now, if Christians, if you and I, if we could get to this place where our souls were known for this freedom, for our gracious ability to love, this welcoming love that God calls us to, then no one, not one person would ever skip over the pages of their entering the promised land. Not one person. Let's stand and confess our faith.